So we take a little hiatus here during the month of February, the month of love, the month of amor. Husbands, you've been put on notice. Just leave it right there, but you've been put on notice. It is the month of Valentine's Day. So get your flower orders in early. Whatever else it is you do, get your one recipe a year worked up. I wanted to take the month of February and really hone in on these important relationships that we call family. We're going to spend the 4 weeks. The first 2 weeks, we're going to focus in on marriage, and then we're going to talk a little bit about parenting. We're going to talk about family finance. Not that that ever causes any friction in a family, but we're going to focus on some of these things. And here's why it matters. The Bible speaks to a lot of different building blocks slash safety mechanisms to a healthy society. And it mentions some of these things that we know, even if you don't think about it, but that the Holy Spirit in our society is a significant safety mechanism slash building block to who we are. The Bible actually refers to the Holy Spirit as the restrainer. There's an ability for us to maintain our society today because the Holy Spirit is restraining the depravity of humanity and the work of Satan in our culture. The Bible speaks to the importance of government as the brandisher of the sword and kind of this institution that God has given as the keeper of societal peace. Now, I'm not saying that the government does those things all the time. I'm just saying that the government as instituted by God exists for that purpose. Because I think all of us would agree, nobody wants a society without government. I mean, that would be anarchy. The Bible speaks to the importance of the church and its role as a building block in society, as the body of Christ, the outlet for our fellowship and for the outlet of the goodness of God in our society. And the Bible speaks loudly to the role of family as the key building block and safety mechanism for what we know as society today. It actually is the first institution that was established by God after creation. The famous pastor and probably even more famous writer named Arthur Pink, he said this about family, and it's just so telling. Now listen to this. He says, "There's no sure basis for societal order or public as well as private virtue until it be laid in the wise regulation of its families. After all, a nation is but the aggregate of its families, and unless there be good husbands and wives, fathers and mothers, sons and daughters, there cannot possibly be good citizens." This is a reflection of what God designed the family to be. Now, we live in a broken world. I get it. Sin came into the world. Everything was marred. Everything was tainted, including the family. But here we are with the idea that maybe if we get back to the elemental purposes of what God designed the family for, there is security and peace in those things. So I'm going to give you this morning, as we start with what there is no family aside from marriage. So we start with marriage over the next couple of weeks. And I want to give you, as today's sermon title elaborates, goals that we strive towards to enable a successful marriage. Now, some of you in here are married. Some of you are maybe widows or widowers. Some of you are not married yet. Some of you are single. The Bible has something to say about marriage to each and every person, wherever their place may be, and here's why. You may be in here and you're married today, And maybe you're going to walk away and you're going to say, all right, so the pastor spoke about these goals today. How am I doing in these areas in my current marriage? But all of us are what the Bible calls disciplers. So we have a responsibility to help the family unit, in particular those who are married, to understand their marriage and live out their marriage to the glory of God. So you're in this thing called the church, right? So there's people in this church that are married, even if you're not. So do you have a role that you can play in order to help the other marriages in the church to be successful? I would say absolutely you do. And then we have young people in the room today, maybe who are not yet married, but they're approaching the age which they're considering marriage. They have a lot of responsibility. Can you imagine being a young Christian adult in today's society and trying to figure out what marriage is going to look like for you? Because we're going to talk about this thing called equally yoked. And it's getting harder and harder to find somebody that you can be equally yoked to. I think that's a lot of why Paul said, you know, it's maybe a blessing that you remain single. Because you can't be unequally yoked and still live out the purposes of God in your life. If you're constantly being drugged down by your marital partner because they're a non-believer. So we need to consider those who are coming up within the church who have this decision in front of them. We need to be praying for them and challenging them to not settle, but to keep their eye focused on what God's best is for their life. Gary Thomas wrote one of my favorite books on marriage. I use it in all my premarital counseling. It's called Sacred Marriage. And he tells his story. You know, he noticed, now he's much older than this now since he wrote the book, but in the book he talks about when he and his wife got to the kind of the 10-year mark of their marriage. And he noticed that somewhere between their honeymoon and the 10-year mark in their marriage, and after having three kids, his marriage went from changing the world for Christ to trying to figure out what movie they're going to watch and staying awake to actually watch that movie. You know, is it Julia Roberts this Friday night or is it Arnold Schwarzenegger? You know, and trying to stay awake after they finally get the kids to bed. Everybody comes into marriage with this pie in the sky, big, elaborate dream of what it's going to be. And reality hits hard, doesn't it? I mean, it really hits hard sometimes. So after a lot of reflection and the study of Scripture, Dr. Thomas came to a simple realization about his marriage and really everybody else's marriage. And when I heard this, when I read this, it revolutionized my view of marriage, my own marriage, and how I counsel other people in their marriages. And he just asked a simple question as a thesis of his book. He said this, perhaps God designed marriage not to make us happy, but to make us holy. Maybe God gave you a spouse not to make you happy, but to make you holy. So biblically speaking, what I want to give you this morning are the first part of some goals that we can kind of build on that idea. Because I think when you enter into marriage and all of a sudden you're living under the roof with another sinful individual, you learn real quick your own sins, your own wickedness. You learn quickly your own temperaments. And you learn quickly that you're living with somebody who is forcing you to come to the reality of what sin is and who you're not in the eyes of God. So when Thomas says, God gave us marriage to make us holy, when you get under the roof with another sinful human being and you live together for years and years and years, you come to a deeper understanding of what the reality of sin is in humanity and how we need to respond to that. So I want to give you the first goal this morning, and we'll get into the scripture right after that. Goal number one to a successful marriage, biblically speaking, is this. Make it a marriage of three. Make it a marriage of three. One of the reasons I love performing weddings is that it is one of the most powerful images of God's covenant of love with his people. When you look at somebody, a biblical Christian marriage, it should point clearly towards a merciful, forgiving, redeeming God in Jesus Christ. The scriptures are riddled with images of marriage as a depiction of how God relates to his people. And at the center of all of it is Jesus Christ. Old Testament and New Testament. How does God view his church? How does God view lost people? How does God redeem lost people? How does God cleanse and sanctify lost people? A healthy Christian marriage is an example, a demonstration of exactly that. Here are a few examples, okay? In Genesis, it was Jesus who created a bride for Adam. In Hosea, when God tells the prophet to... I love the minor prophet book of Hosea. When God tells the prophet to lavish love on his wife, it's just she's not just any normal average wife. She's a wife who had been adulterous towards him, had slept around, and was now living the life of prostitution. And God's word to Hosea is, I want you to go and love your wife again. I want you to purchase her back at the price of a slave. This is not, think about it. Is this not what Jesus Christ did for you? Are you not the adulterous one in this marriage with the bride? We are the bride. He is the groom. We're the adulterous bride who has cheated on our loving God through our sin. And what the groom did was, he paid the price of a slave. He paid the price of a slave caught in sin on the cross in order that he might purchase back for us what seems like an unredeemable, adulterous bride. That's what Christ did. This is Hosea chapter 2, beginning in verse 19. The Lord said to Hosea, "And I will betroth you to me forever. I will betroth you to me in righteousness and in justice, in steadfast love and mercy. I will betroth you to me in faithfulness, and you shall know the Lord. And in that day I will answer, declares the Lord. I will answer the heavens, and they shall answer the earth, and the earth shall answer the grain, the wine, and the oil, and they shall answer Jezreel. And I will sow her for myself in the land, and I will have mercy on no mercy. And I will say to not my people, you are my people. And he shall say, you are my God." See, the Lord is interested in a redeeming love for a sinful people that want nothing to do with him. For the people who throw up their hands and say, "I can't belong to the Lord because I've cheated on him. I've done too much." God says, "I'll buy you back. I'll pay any price necessary in order to make you my bride." This is the power of the image that God wants our marriages as Christians to witness to the rest of the world. Think back to your wedding day and answer in your mind honestly, why did you get married? Was it to give or to get? Was it to give love or to get love? Did you get married to be loved or to love another? Your answer says a lot about your view of Christ in marriage. Jesus loved us first. That was his priority. You're not promised in the Bible anywhere that another will love you in your life aside from Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. You're not promised in the Bible anywhere that another person will love you except for Jesus Christ. He will love you and he will always love you. And he will never give up on that love for you. When you enter into a marital relationship, oftentimes we're reminded that nobody is perfect. People disappoint us, don't they? I don't want to step on any toes here this morning, but even in marriage, people disappoint us. All right, then. I'll be available for counseling this week. Jesus, if he's the third person in your marriage, does not disappoint, ever. He gives us both parties in the marriage purpose and the value of redemption. Jesus, in Scripture, is always the bridegroom, right? So look at Matthew 25, verses 1 to 13. It's like God's trying to drive a point home here with the parable of the virgins, the 10 virgins. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and they went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. For when the foolish took the lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, "Here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Then all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "Since there will not be enough for us and for you, go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves." And while they were going to buy, the bridegroom came. And those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open the door to us." But he answered, "Truly, I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." Again, this image of Jesus as our bridegroom waiting with the anticipation for us to welcome him, to receive him. We prepare our hearts for him. A marriage between a husband and wife should look like the relationship between Christ and his church. And we'll get into more of that in just a second. But in putting Christ at the center of your marriage, all of us articulate a huge kingdom principle. And it's this. It's the principle of the perfect bridegroom and his love for his bride as he returns to redeem her. And in case you've never thought of your marriage this way, let me challenge you with this. Your marriage, between you, husband and wife, may be the only gospel other people ever get to witness in their life. I don't ever perform a marriage ceremony without sharing the gospel. Because, honestly, it's like somebody teeing up a golf ball for you, right? Like, it's just right. It's too easy. It's too easy. A good pastor should never perform a wedding or a funeral without sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Your marriage is probably the best way for your spouse to experience the love of Christ. You, husband or wife, are the primary outlet for your loved one to experience the love of Christ. So the first goal, which has to be in place in order for the rest of them really to make sense and to build upon, the first goal is to make it a marriage of three. If you're here this morning, you've never invited Christ into your life, or maybe you've never invited Christ into your marriage, let today be the day. It's not hard. This isn't some program that you have to sign up for or, you know, log in online and get a membership for. This is quite simply just a heart decision. This is where you can sit in a room like this on a Sunday morning and you can say to God, "I don't exactly know how. I don't think I'll be perfect at it. But Lord, I want you to have me and my life. I give you my sin, my brokenness. I believe Jesus died for me. I want him as Lord and Savior." That gives you eternal life. And then when you invite him into your marriage, you say, "I want him to be preeminent, first and foremost, between my wife and I. I want him to rule over our marriage and our home." When you invite him in to that, then it's like dominoes just start falling. And when you do that, you'll be amazed at the work that Christ can do in and through your marriage. Here's the second goal this morning. Don't set unreasonable expectations. So the first goal, make it a marriage of three. Second goal, don't set unreasonable expectations. So going back to Genesis. Genesis chapter 2 ends with the uniting of a man and a woman and God's good gift of marriage and intimacy. Chapter 3 moves us immediately into Eve being deceived and sinning, and then Adam following suit. So we went from the greatest gift God could ever give to Adam to next chapter, them wrecking it, destroying it with sin. One marriage, two sinners. It doesn't seem like it should work. And look at their response in Genesis. Look at Genesis chapter 3. So they sin, they get caught, and God approaches them in verse 9. But the Lord God called to man and said to him, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" And the man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit of the tree and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" And the woman said, No, the serpent deceived me and I ate." See what's going on here? It's the blame game. Yeah, not that we do that in marriage today. But they chose that the best answer to being caught in their sin was to double down in their sin. If you read the Old Testament, you'll notice that this is just part and parcel for every story in the Old Testament. Now, if somebody's caught in sin and they decide that the best answer to that is to sin again, to try and get out of their sin. When we choose to sit, here's what happens. We come into this marriage as two messed up individuals. And I mean that in all loving respect, because I'm looking in a mirror when I say that. We all come into a marriage as just depraved, foul in the eyes of God, wicked at the center of a heart to a depth we could never understand it. And we come into this holy union. And there needs to be expectations on our part that you're not marrying perfection. You're marrying a sinner. When we choose to set unreasonable expectations and forget that we live in a sinful relationship, it's going to do something awful. I think the first thing it's going to do is it's going to breed contempt. Like, you're just going to slowly abhor that person. They're going to grow and you're going to grow in disdain for them. They're going to frustrate you. And dumb things like wet towels on the bathroom floor are going to turn into absolute animosity and anger and hostility. Why are y'all laughing? You're going to walk past a sink full of dishes and you're going to think to yourself, "I did those last night and the night before and the night before. The dishwasher's right there. What's wrong with them?" And it breeds more contempt and more contempt. Now, I'm using lighthearted examples, but I think we could all think of even more serious examples than this. I don't know if not putting dishes in the dishwasher is a sin or not. I'm not going to debate that. But we could say that if it is hindering your marriage, maybe it is. Maybe you need to do something about it. When we choose to set unreasonable expectations and forget that we live in a sinful relationship, something else happens. I think true love begins to dwindle. True marital love. See, because true marital love, agape love, doesn't allow expectations to breed contempt, but rather chooses gratitude. We'll get into that in a second too in 1 Corinthians 13. But true love doesn't allow contempt and disdain to take root, but rather seeks out gratitude for what we've been given. We are two broken people brought into a relationship that really, at a surface level, has no business surviving. And yet, there you are, day after day, waking with the same person. I think when we realize that we are broken people traveling the same course under one roof, it can help us with our expectations. I have a short video I want to show you that kind of illustrates this.
When you look at me, no, we're not the fairy tale you dreamed we'd be. You wore the veil, you walked the aisle, you took my hand, and we dove into a mystery. How I wish we could go back to simpler times, before all our scars and all our secrets were in the light. Now on this hallowed ground we've drawn the battle line. Will we make it through the night? It's gonna take much more and promises this time. Only God can change our mind. Maybe you and I were never meant to be complete. Could we just be broken together? If you can bring your shattered dreams and now bring mine, could healing still be spoken? And save us. The only way we'll last forever is broken together. How it must have been so lonely by my side. We were building kingdoms and chasing dreams and left love behind. I'm praying God will help our broken hearts align, and we won't give up the fight. It's gonna take much more and promises this time. Only God can change our mind. Maybe you and I were never meant to be complete. Could we just be broken together? If you can bring your shattered dreams and now bring mine, could healing still be spoken and save us? The only way we'll last forever is broken together. Could we just be broken together? If you can bring your shattered dreams and I'll bring mine. Can healing still be spoken and save us? The only way will last forever is broken together.
That's the difference between romance and love. Is kind of the difference between lust and longevity. It's kind of the difference between passion and purpose in your marriage. So as you remember those nights of in your marriage when you had late night talks, you think about the long car rides that before children were hassle-free. The inability to see errors in others that one day just went away. Gary Chapman put it this way. The sensation of being, quote, in love develops around blissful emotions and a warped view that your significant other has no flaws and is perfect. Real love is a choice that involves effort, discipline, and intentional purpose. That's marriage. It's work. I also want to say here, as a pastor, a million heads swirl around, or a million things swirl around in my head as I put together a sermon, and I'm keenly aware of the fact that some marriages are irreparably broken. We call this divorce. And it's wrong to think that the grace of God and the love of Jesus Christ stops there, because it does not. We continue on as broken people. Sometimes divorce makes the brokenness hurt more. And yet, God, by His grace, is not done with us. We are blessed in that because He's the one that loves us unconditionally and forever, we always are married to the bridegroom. And even if something happens that a marriage is irreparably broken, God is good enough to love us consistently and unconditionally no matter what. And a lot of folks who go through a divorce, they think, God's upset with me, or God can't do anything with me, or they feel like maybe they've lost favor with God. No, that's not the case. God is a God of Romans 8:28. God is a God who can do great things out of ashes and brokenness. I'm an example of that. I came from a father who had been married before and was divorced, and a mother who had been married before and was divorced. I have four older siblings, all of them half siblings. I'm the only one between my mother and I, and my father and I. And they married and they stayed married, and I like to think that my life is an example that God is not done blessing and working in people's lives, even after divorce. Goal number three this morning is this. Dump the list of wrongs. Dump the list of wrongs. One of the saddest and most consistent traits in broken or breaking marriages is one where one or both of the spouses is keeping a list of wrongs of the other. Towels always on the floor. Dishes are always in the sink. Toilet paper roll is always empty. Right? Toilets never cleaned. Seat's always up. Thank you, Pam. That sounds like a grandmother who spends a lot of time in the house with grandsons. So goal two reminded us that we live with sinners. Because of that, we're going to have many words that are spoken harshly to us. We're going to have many dishes that go undone. We are going to have many days watching football instead of prioritizing something else. Many nights where miscommunication may lead to missed intimate opportunities. Whatever it is that is grating on us, it is important to remember that we live with sinners and there's no use in keeping a list of wrongs. We remember 1 Corinthians 13, where Paul described for us what true biblical love looked like. And this is what he said. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy, is not boastful, is not arrogant, is not rude, is not self-seeking, is not irritable, and does not keep a record of wrongs. Love finds no joy in unrighteousness, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. I keep my, years ago, my mother crocheted 1 Corinthians 13, the definition of love, and she had it framed, and we keep it on the wall, center wall of our living room. And now one of our, my marital, premarital lessons with couples is that we sit down and I teach them from 1 Corinthians 13 and we go through each point as far as what true love looks like so that we set the expectations at an appropriate level. And oftentimes we end up pointing to my mother's thing on the wall, you know, like, see what it says here? I don't think my mom made it ever expecting that that would be part of her legacy. But most married couples that are premarital couples that we've counseled have been forced to look at that thing hanging on the wall as we go through Romans or 1 Corinthians 13. Here's the problem with keeping lists. List keepers have identifying marks. List keepers, they may be what I call dumpers. So a dumper is a list keeper who at any given moment when the opportunity presents itself is just ready to vomit out all the complaints at one time, right? You never do this. I bet you didn't know you do this, and you do this, and you do this, and you don't do this, and I'm just tired of it. And the person is like, whoa, where did this come from? No communication. The second are quoters. I call them quoters. These are people who can pull up the exact words that you said from years ago. Have you seen that commercial? It shows during football games a lot of times where husbands and wives are arguing and then somebody says, all right, let's throw the red flag. We're going to replay. And so, and the referee comes in and pulls up the camera and shows replay from exactly what happened. And inevitably, one of the spouses is like, see, I told you. Well, sadly, that's a bad example because sadly, there's a lot of spouses that do that every day. They're looking for the opportunity to say to their spouse, I told you, or you said this and you were wrong. The quoters. And then there's what I call the magnifiers. These are people who are going to utilize the smallest of past things to make it into something bigger, right? So like, you left a towel on the floor wet, and all of a sudden that has turned into a huge conversation about how you don't value me because you never do the laundry, you never help with anything around the house, and all of a sudden, that spouse is like, where did this come from? Kind of goes along with being a dumper, I guess. Some list keepers arrive at such an unhealthy place that I think they actually find joy in adding to the list. And could you imagine living in a marriage where the greatest joy was to find yet one more thing that you disliked about your spouse? But it's happening. If your view of marriage is for the other to meet a list of your needs or requirements, then you need to go back to goal number one, which was make it a marriage of three. That other person, if you're waiting on a human being to meet your needs, good luck. Only Jesus Christ can meet your needs. That's the beauty of the gospel, isn't it? That's why I say living out a healthy biblical marriage is such an example of the gospel to other people. When people come to you and they say, wow, your marriage has been so great. What's the secret? I hope what you don't say is, well, my spouse has really just met all my expectations. They've been so good to me, I've never had any complaints. That's so unrealistic. If you said that, I'd call you out. Be like, nah, you're lying. But if a believer said to me, oh, we quickly came to realization that neither of us are perfect, but Jesus is. So he's the one that we count on. I'd say, oh, that's a healthy marriage, for sure. And somebody says, well, how does Jesus make it better? Because Jesus has forgiven us both. And because we've been forgiven, he's commanded us to forgive. That's the gospel, isn't it? Goal number four, last one for today. Goal number four in a successful marriage is to worship together. Worship together. I've heard it many times, as I'm sure you have. Marriage and parenthood has taught me more about God than anything else. When you go into a marriage or when you try and raise a small child, you realize how absolutely helpless you are. I remember when they locked my oldest in the car seat in the back, and he was like barely bigger than a walnut, and the nurses started waving as we drove away from SMH, and we're both looking at each other like, where's the manual? Where's the permission slip? You know, you feel like it needs to be bigger than this. We wanted to scream at the top of our lungs, we don't trust us. You shouldn't trust us either. Boy, we leaned on God hard. And our mothers. Because much like worship, here's why. Much like worship, marriage refocuses us on God's character, God's qualities, God's abilities, and our need for him that goes beyond our sinfulness. There's no way Mindy could have been married to me now for 25 years apart from her trusting Jesus Christ in her life. So closely tied together is marriage and our relationship with God that God, listen up, men, God hearing our prayers is hindered in the midst of marital disobedience. That's not my opinion. That's what the Bible says in 1 Peter 3:7. Peter said, likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. See, there must have been an issue with men in the early church not loving and treating their wives the way Christ would. And it said that a result of that is that they felt like their prayers were being hindered. That vertical relationship with the Heavenly Father was hitting a barrier because they weren't demonstrating Christ to the most important person in their life. Men carry a huge responsibility, and we'll get into this a little bit more next week, but a huge responsibility in leading spiritually. So man, it's a mystery, but pray to have a better marriage so that you can pray and worship together. Dr. Thomas put it this way, Gary Thomas, he said, according to 1 Peter 3, men, once married, God now views you through the lens of your wife. Genesis's view of ministry was given by God. Man needed woman as a helpmate. That's what the book of Genesis said. I preach this at every marriage ceremony. God looked at that when I'm marrying a young couple. I look at that young man and I say, with all seriousness, God looked at you and knew that you needed earnest help. So he gave you a bride, a helpmate. Man needs a woman as a helpmate, not to be alone, and to successfully fulfill the work of the Lord in his life. This is the story of Genesis 2. And I'm going to just kind of skip that passage, but just say quickly, when man was given a job to do, and he was doing that job, God looked and realized, a bit of crisis actually, he looked at the man and realized that it wasn't good for him to be alone, that he did need help. So he put the man under a deep sleep, which I'm sure didn't take much at all, put him under a deep sleep, and then bone from bone, he opened up Adam's torso, took out part of a rib, and he fashioned the woman. That's the only time man has ever, or woman's ever come from man. Ever since then, everybody has come henceforth out of a woman. But in the beginning, God took from a man in order to make a woman. Bone for bone and flesh for flesh, partners forever. You two were made to operate in the realm of worship, and more than just your happiness, God gave you to each other for His happiness. Say that again. More than the importance of your happiness is that God gave you each other for His happiness. Your husband is God's son. Your wife is God's daughter. Love them well, and you love God well. That's worship. Worshiping God in marriage, it starts with your love and treatment towards one another. Worshiping God in marriage, it means seeing your union as a vehicle to honor, praise, and serve Him better. Pray together. Bring God into all your conversations. Bring the desire and the purpose to God into all your decisions, and let those family decisions glorify and benefit Him first. Give thanks for the gifts that you've been given as a couple, including one and the other. Serve sacrificially one and another, and then serve the world sacrificially out of your union together. It is amazing. It's not common math, but it's like when God brought Mindy into my life with me, He brought one and one, and it's like He didn't make two. He did this exponential work to do so much more as a couple than we could have ever dreamed doing individually. And there's no way that, and if a man is being honest, he would have to admit that there's no way he'd be where he is in the Lord apart from the support and love of a godly wife. So there's more to say on this. We'll dig into a little bit more next week. I run the risk of stepping on more toes next week and having a few laughs along the way. But I'll reiterate them one more time. Make it a marriage of three. Don't set unreasonable expectations. Dump the list of wrongs and worship together. Worship together.